There was a time on the professional golf tour when fairways weren't fair. When, as in so many other sports and realms of society, African Americans weren't allowed. So they formed a tour of their own. A tour played on pitted fairways and rock-strewn greens from Cleveland to Charleston. And while there was little money and little fanfare, there was major talent. Golfers who did honor to the game and to themselves. The United Golfers Association wasn't so much a tour as a journey to self-respect, self-reliance, and better times ahead. This is the story of uneven fairways. When African Americans denied a place on the tour, still found a place in the sun.
I started caddying when I was 13 years old to make money, to help my family.
There was a means of surviving, making money. My father didn't bring home but $11 a week during that time. So that was a lot of money, me bringing home $6 the first day. And my mother wanted to know where I got that money from.
Well, I was the best caddy on the golf course, and I always got the best golfers, so.
Yeah, most of the kids taught themselves back then how to play golf. When we got up old enough, we would go to the golf course and caddy, and we would hit the golfers' clubs.
Make 60 cents for 18 holes. I gave my mother the 50 cent, and I'd take the dime and buy a cigar.
When I was starting to play golf, most of the guys that played the game were caddies, and I played with the caddies, and I loved the competition.
I walked around caddying with that bag on my shoulder for 18 holes and no shoes.
We never wore golf shoes until we got on the tour. We never knew what golf shoes was.
Them Santa Spurs used to eat my feet up. When I got home at night, I took a needle and picked those Santa Spurs out the bottom of my feet.
The history of African American golf began in the caddy shacks of America's golf clubs. Every young black man learned the game by watching the swings of others. Such greats as John Shippen, Charlie Sifford, Pete Brown, Ted Rhodes, Jim Thorpe, they all started that way, hoping to earn a living and perhaps leave a legacy.
I started playing when I was 3, taught by my father, and actually it was sort of like growing up on a farm. It was just a grass farm.
I didn't start playing golf until I was 23 years old, and I didn't even know black people played golf, you know. It was amazing the things that we did, you know what I mean? Like if we found a golf club, man, it was nothing for us to go find a tobacco stick and trim it down and make that thing fit, you know what I mean? And you get some epoxy or something and put that thing in there, and you take it out the next day, shit, you had your golf club, man. No grip, no grip or nothing of that nature. You just grabbed it and you hit it.
Never even thought about it.
I mean, you take one golf ball, the golf ball would be brown as my face, man. And you just play this golf. Well, you made a difference how far it went. You just went ahead and played. Now, do you think Tiger Woods would ever know that we used to make golf clubs out of tobacco stick? That we'd make a putter from an old hickory dogwood tree?
What we would do is we played in the projects. We made our own golf course, you know, in the projects because we couldn't play on the golf course. And I was a pretty good ball striker before I ever played a round of golf on the golf course.
It was no griping and carrying on about it. It was just the way of life. And I loved it. At that time, I loved it.
In 1925, at the Shady Rest Golf Course in Scotch Plains, New Jersey, the first Negro National Open was contested. The tournament led to the creation of a Negro Leagues of Golf, sometimes called the Chitlin' Circuit. The United Golfers Association, the UGA, gave black men and women a chance to compete, try and eke out a living, and let them hope that their dreams of professional golf were possible. Without the UGA, players such as Charlie Sifford, Lee Elder, Calvin Peet, Jim Thorpe, Jim Dent, and Tiger Woods might have taken up another professional sport.
Black people, being very resourceful, wanted to play, and so in 1925, a group of black businessmen met in a YMCA in Washington, D.C. And they basically said, well, PGA won't let us play on their tour, so we'll start our own tour. And that's what they did, the UGA.
UGA was important because it gave those blacks the opportunity to play in golf tournaments. There were so many guys that had so much talent to play the game, but couldn't play it at the highest level.
It was, for a long time, the only significant outlet for blacks to play, and they did women and they did men.
All the black, young black golfers, that's where they played. I mean, you know, Lee Elder, Charlie Sifford, Calvin Pete later. Calvin didn't play as many tournaments as those guys did, but Lee and Charlie and Teddy Rose and Rafe Botts and that's where those guys got their start.
When I went on the UGA tour, we got there the best way we could. Sometimes we catch a bus. Some of the players might have a car. We get with them and ride with them. The rest area was my motel.
Sometimes it'd be four or five of us, you know, when we would all stay in the same room, you know, because the money was scarce.
We all travel together anyway, but we helped each other. If black didn't have no money to get a tournament, somebody would give it to him. If I didn't have no money, somebody would give it to me. Whoever won a tournament the week before would give you the money to put you in the tournament. We did that kind of stuff and didn't look for the money back. If you were hungry, we gonna feed you, man. We're not gonna let you go around hungry.
They were gonna eat, because I always carried an electric pot with me and a frying pan.
We helped each other because we on that road out there, nobody really had a lot of money. You know what I mean? We didn't have a lot of money out there, you know. So we had to help each other. And the guys never mind doing it.
And it was a joy to be around, but it was separate. It was totally separate and not equal.
The golf courses that we played the tour on was all municipalities. They was not in the greatest shape. In a golf tournament. Gary Player played in the Norfolk, and I never will forget the third hole, and there was a bunker right in front of the hole. And Gary Player hit a driver and a one iron, and he stuck it right at the top of the lip, unplayable. And he looked at me and said, lad, he said, if y'all can play under these conditions, y'all to be the greatest players in the world.
Of course I understand the conditions and the courses they played. They were not the most pristine. They were very difficult. They always had bad lies, and you had to learn how to, basically, you know how to become a shot maker. You had to actually play shots. You had to know what lies did.
It was a tour where you got to know everybody, and you go to different cities, and you'd come back the following year. You'd meet a lot of people, and it was more like a fraternity or sorority type thing.
Oh, it was tons of fun, man. I mean, we got together, man, and we laughed and we cut up and. I mean, we would show up at golf tournaments with a half a set of clubs. You know, one golf ball, we lost a golf ball, we had to withdraw from the tournament. We walked off the course. And, you know, even we was out there playing, Charlie, we walked down the fairway, down the edge of the rough, looking for a golf ball. Man, hoping we could find one, just in case we lost it.
The Chiller Circus, they called it. I had some of the best time I had in my life out there playing that circus. Really had a good time.
When we speak of the UGA, we must understand that this is not just about black people playing golf. It's also about responsibly and with a great deal of acumen and competency running an organization. Rules have to be enforced. Schedules have to be arranged. Courses have to be set up. So there are lots of things here that are about being administrators, about being managers. So it's very important for blacks to demonstrate that they can indeed do these types of things.
If you were to compare the purses back then, Harry Jackson, who won the very first Negro National Open in 1925, got $25 for his effort. At the time, a tour event would have paid maybe $250 to the first place finisher.
Couldn't get no sponsors. Nobody would give us no money. I tried all kind of companies. They give us some money to have the tournaments, and nobody wanted to give up any money.
You know, sometimes you go to places where you don't really know the people putting a tournament on. You pay your entry fee. And they take all the money and leave. We're in Virginia Beach, Virginia, man. I got a $2,500 check. I'm calling everybody I know talking about how much money I want. And I tell you what, I was so disappointed on Monday. I go to the bank to cash the check, man. I was just sick. My stomach just turned. I'm saying, what do you mean there's no money in the account? You know?
See, that's why.
But that happens sometimes, though.
And that's a heartbreaking situation. You win a golf tournament, and there's no money.
In 1981 in Marion, Pennsylvania, I was leading the U.S. Open. No one knew this. I don't even think my wife knew this, that I was dead broke. Absolutely dead broke. I couldn't buy breakfast. I couldn't buy a bowl of 69-cent cereal. If they had not had food in the locker room, an apple or orange or something of that nature, I couldn't eat. I'm dead serious. When I tell you the only thing I had in my pocket was a penny to mark my ball with, I'm not lying to you.
How did these guys live? They hustled. They had side jobs. And the very lucky ones had benefactors.
My means of getting around the golf, I worked for him for 5 years as a private golf instructor, Billy Eckstein. And I used to take his clothes to the theater and I'd find a golf course. And I would go play. So he was paying me $150 a week. And that's how I got supported me around the golf courses.
People must understand that you do what you have to do to survive. And at that particular time, I couldn't compete on the PGA Tour, so I turned to hustling. And you could travel around the country, Chicago, Detroit, and many places, South Florida and all that sort of stuff, Baltimore, Washington, and you could get a lot of nice money games. You know, no, you wasn't going to go out there and get rich, but you could pay some bills.
So you go into a town, and you're looking for the best player. And so you're going to get action because they didn't think you could play anyway.
James Black would hustle you. If you couldn't play, James Black, he knew exactly how many shots to give you so he can beat you. And he'd make you feel good. When you walked off, he said, boy, you know, if I hadn't missed that putt on 15 or 16, I'd have beat this guy.
I got to the point in my life that I thought that I was the greatest player in the world. I made over $4 million in the 60s gambling. I used to enter tournaments and put my entry fee in and wouldn't play in the golf tournament. It wasn't enough money. And we'd go to other golf courses and have gambling games. It was better social economical for me.
I knew all the good players, and I knew the guys who was most likely going to beat me the next week if I didn't use a little finessing on them. I would give a party. I would buy sometime a case of liquor, $150 worth of fried chicken, Kentucky, and then I'd have some girls come in there. And the BBC is like a 38 to the head to a golfer. Booze, brawls, and the clock. Okay? So I had the booze, I had the clock, and I had the brawls. That's all I need, because they drank while they was drinking and having fun. I was getting my rest.
In 1896, two young caddies from America played in the U.S. Open on the hallowed fairways of Shinnecock Hills. These two Americans played despite the protests of an almost entirely European field. The Europeans were not protesting letting these young men play because they were American. They protested because these young caddies were minorities, one being black. The black caddy, John Shippen, would go on to share the lead after the first round, finish fifth, and then soon become America's first golf professional.
There was a question with respect to the heritage of John Shippen in that he did have a Shinnecock Indian mother. It's similar to Tiger Woods in that he is of mixed racial heritage.
John Shippen was the person who, along with several members of the UGA, founded Shady Wrist Golf
Club, the first black-owned country club. He was the head pro there for a number of years.
Shady Rest had, in addition to the golf facilities, it also had skeet shooting, it had tennis courts, it had all kinds of social activities. It was really the first what you could call a country club atmosphere in the United States. Most of the prominent black performers would go on a circuit where they would perform in Harlem. They'd come over to New Jersey and perform at Shady Rest. You had these very prominent performers like Duke Ellington, Billy Eckstein, Ella Fitzgerald performed at Shady Rest at one time or another. And you had this ironic situation where you would have white folks standing outside listening to the music.
White golfers were always welcome on the sister tours of the UGA, the Western States Golf Association, and the North American Golfers Association.
There was definitely white players who played in the UGA. There was white players who played in the Negro Nationals. They didn't care. We didn't care who they were. If they put up the entry fee, they could play.
I remember the first time I walked up to enter a UGA event, and I imagine I was pretty apprehensive because I knew that the PGA had a Caucasian clause in this constitution. So I could understand the resentment that some of the players might feel, but I never felt a drop of it.
Article 3, Section 1 of the PGA Constitution, as it existed in 1960. Male professional golfers of the Caucasian race over the age of 18 years residing in North or South America who can qualify under the terms and conditions hereinafter specified shall be eligible for membership.
Well, the Caucasian-only clause basically said that membership in the PGA of America and play on its tour was restricted to Caucasian males, which meant that blacks couldn't compete.
There's no reason in the world to stop a man from playing golf on a golf course. I don't know what nobody can hurt on 125 acres of land with one little golf ball this big. You know, it's not too much he can hurt.
I like to speak of golf in the past as having had a culture of exclusion. It was a sport that was based in a country club culture of discrimination, of segregation, of privacy, of elitism, of exclusion. And we also have to look at the country club as more than a place where golf is played. The country club is a place where people want to feel comfortable, in quotes, with one another, where their children and wives also participate, where they hope that bloodlines will be extended. And so to have blacks invade this sacred social and cultural and community space was to basically invite blacks into your home.
No, I never looked at golf as a white and black thing, you know, because see, most of my, I would say my fellow competitors, even as an amateur, most of them were white, you know. So it wasn't like, oh, there's the black guy there. You know, no, we were friends, but we were also competitors.
As far as me playing against you, and if we're playing competition, the idea of the game is to win the game. So being white doesn't matter to me. If I could beat you, I'd beat you as bad as I could possibly beat you. You know, if you were black and we were playing for the same thing, I want to beat you as bad as I can beat you too. Now, after it's over, I'm willing to shake your hand and say, hey, good round. And I'm hoping that you'll do the same thing with me.
When the great Joe Louis won the heavyweight boxing championship of the world over James J. Braddock in 1937, he made all African Americans proud. A year later, in 1938, by knocking out Max Smelling in 2 minutes and 4 seconds of the first round of their rematch, he made all of America proud. In one of his next great fights, Joe Louis, the former heavyweight champion of the world, became the first African American to break the color barrier of the PGA when he played in the 1952 San Diego Open.
Is Joe Louis a hero? Yes, I would think that anyone who knew of Joe Louis would say that Joe Louis is a hero.
My name is Joe Luis Barrow. I was born in Mexico City, Mexico. My dad is Joe Luis, former heavyweight champion of the world. My dad was a great individual. He was an individual who loved boxing, loved people, and he just enjoyed the game of golf. Many people say that it was golf that was the reason that he lost to Max Schmeling in 1936, because he was more focused on learning the game of golf as opposed to being prepared for Max Schmeling.
If you would read some of the history on golf, you would find that Joe was the person who really got the blacks an opportunity to play some tournaments on the tour.
In 1952, he was invited to play in the San Diego Open by the sponsors. They didn't know that there was a non-Caucasian clause and that if you weren't a member of the PGA, you couldn't play in a PGA Tour event. And blacks were not allowed to be members of the PGA. When he learned that, he said, well, you know, they're just going to have to tell me to my face. So Joe Luis travels out to San Diego, the former heavyweight champion of the world. And as it turns out, they allowed him to qualify for the tournament along with some black pros. My father did qualify for the tournament, and they let him play as an amateur, and he played with the then president of the PGA. The black pros who qualified were not able to play. Once again, a segregated game of golf. They let him play as an amateur under a sponsor's exemption. About that, he was the first to play in a PGA Tour event, and that became his cause.
Joe Luis was such a pioneer for every black in the United States, let alone just the golfers. But he loved the game of golf. He loved to hang around with the golfers, and the golfers loved hanging around Joe.
There are several times that I played Joe Luis, and he would like to play with me, and I enjoyed playing with him. And I beat him, and he wouldn't pay me. And he said, we have a tee time at 10-something the next day, and the next day he'll pay me before we play. So one day, I told him, I said, you got to pay me today. He said to me, he said, if you think you're big enough, take it.
Only thing we had difficult about Joe, we had to follow him home to get paid off, you know. He wouldn't pay us off right on the spot.
It was said that Bill Spiller was able to buy a house on the earnings from his bets with Joe Luis. Those are rumors, of course.
Now, the unique thing about Joe Luis is that he understood something called pride. And, you know, the black pros who needed to earn a living also had the pride that they just didn't want to be given money. So Joe Luis figured out ways to get money to him through some of these tournaments with purses, through some serious games that he lost. But the realities are Joe Luis helped support a lot of people in this country who were striving to be successful in their professions and couldn't.
Yes, I met Joe Luis. Met him in Detroit, 10 years old. I stood in line for at least two and a half hours to get that picture from Joe Luis. And when I got to Joe Luis, all I could do was just hold up my head because he looked like he was 10 feet tall to me. My mouth just fell open. And all I could think about in my mind was one day I'd like to be like Joe Luis.
I think I'd describe my father as a hero. Once my father won the title in 1937, he clearly was admired by all of black America because they have the heavyweight champion of the world. The most powerful individual in the world was a black man, and that gave them a sense of self-worth and respect. But white America still questioned him. But once he defeated Max Schmeling in 1938, that was clearly my father's most famous fight. That's when he transcended from a heavyweight champion to a true American hero because of Nazi Germany, Hitler, the Aryan race, the superior race. And my father certainly proved it wrong because he knocked Max out in 2 minutes and 4 seconds of the first round.
I mean, all America was proud. Now, they wouldn't let him play golf at anybody's country club, and they didn't invite him to dinner in a lot of restaurants and stuff like that. But it was like everybody was proud. Why? Because the American beat the German. And all of a sudden, we're all Americans in together. Well, where the hell did that go?
Yeah, he was an American hero from way back. But it didn't make no difference. He had the wrong color skin. You just bone black, that's all.
You know, segregation is just very unfortunate. You know, there's so many opportunities that were missed in this country because blacks were placed in a place that didn't allow them with opportunities. And that's certainly clear in golf and certainly clear in other sports. You know, the irony of that statement is that, you know, people today don't understand segregation in sport because there's so many people from diverse backgrounds dominating certain sports. But every now and then you have a breakthrough, and every now and then it's a new ground. I mean, clearly Tiger is doing that in golf, but, you know, you had pioneers before him, Charlie Siffert, Lee Elder, Calvin Pete, Jim Dent. If you ask any of those older golfers, they'd say that probably that the reason they're playing golf today or throughout their career was because of Joe Louis.
Bill Spiller, I regard as one of the most tragic figures in the whole game of golf. Here was a man who was capable of playing the game at a very high level, but he was a very proud man, and he was denied the opportunity to play, and he resented it bitterly.
Bill Spiller Sr. was my father. His role involved being a pioneer in the development of not only the PGA, but the opportunity for minority players, particularly African-American players, to play on the professional golf tour.
Bill Spiller won dozens of tournaments on the UGA Tour. Unlike many of his contemporaries, Bill Spiller was a college graduate. This alumnus from Wiley College who wrote poetry wanted to earn a living at his chosen profession, golf. But he was forced to caddy and even take a job at LA's Union Station in order to support his family.
It was particularly tough on individuals, anyone who would discriminate against him or his family. He was a caddy and became quite a great player. He was good enough to compete against the best white players of the day, good enough to share the first round lead in the LA Open with the great Ben Hogan.
He was very, very interested in trying to make sure that we had a chance to play in the PGA.
In 1948, Bill Spiller, Teddy Rhodes, and Madison Gunther brought a lawsuit against the PGA for refusing them entry into the Richmond Open outside Oakland, California. The trio had qualified the week before in the LA Open. The PGA sidestepped the suit by changing the designation of its events from opens to invitationals. African Americans rarely, if ever, made the list of invitees.
So what really was thought to be a victory was in fact not. The PGA broke my dad's heart, as well as a number of other golfers who should have had an opportunity to play. The PGA broke their hearts as well. My dad saw himself as a golfer that was entitled to earn a living playing golf. He believed in the principles of if one hits you, you hit back. I can recount one incident that occurred in San Diego where when he was not permitted to play in a professional tournament, he sat down on the tee so that the other players could not tee off.
The picture of Bill Spiller seated with his golf clubs, forlornly and angrily protesting his treatment, is one of the pictorial icons, you might say, of black golf.
The record shows that few Caucasians stood up for the black golfer during that era. One man did. His name was Stanley Mosk. He was the Attorney General for the state of California.
We used to play every day at Hillcrest Country Club, Jewish club in Los Angeles, California, and Stanley was a member there. So I used to shoot 66, 67, 68.
One day, said, Charlie said we were having the PGA tournament there at Wilshire Country Club. So he said to me, Charlie, if you play as well as you're playing now, you can win that tournament next week. So I said, what tournament? He said, the PGA. I said, they're not going to let me play. So he said, why? I said, the Constitution stated only Caucasian. He said, what did that mean? I said, well, I'm black and they white. He said to me, you won't let me down, Wade. So I said, no. So he said, okay, I'm going to call them Monday morning. And if they don't let you play, I'm going to make them take the tournament out of the state of California.
The PGA announced that it would then move the tournament to Pennsylvania. And at that point, the NAACP and others began lobbying against the holding of that tournament there. And finally, the PGA voted to repeal the whites-only clause from their constitution.
This cleared the way for Charlie Sifford and others to take their rightful position alongside Arnie, Jack, and the other great players on the PGA Tour.
I think my father was a hero, but I also think that the Charlie Sifford and the other golfers at that time who had to fight for their rights are also heroes, just like Jackie Robinson and others who broke the color barrier. Later, my father was interviewed about the events that took place in the 60s concerning the PGA, and he responded, it was a sporting event, for goodness sakes. What's color got to do with it?
My name is Peggy White. Ted Rhodes was my dad. I don't think my father was aware of what a trailblazer he was.
And Teddy Rhodes may have been arguably the greatest black golfer before Tiger.
I believe he had an individual dream and a passion. And I say this, and I say this with a lot of pride, obviously being his daughter. He had a dream that he would become the finest golfer in the world. But I don't think he realized that he actually accomplished.
Teddy Rhodes was one of the greatest golfers that I ever seen.
You ever play him for money?
I played him. It took me 5 years to beat him. I didn't play him because he's the best player out there, so I didn't want to do that. I don't want nothing that hard. I want something soft.
This kid was sitting there. I know, forget this, because this kid had the golf bag, had the practice bag sitting down there, standing down in front of him. He was standing behind the bag with a towel in his hand, and Teddy was hitting like 3 irons at him. And it was a matter of just walking 2 feet to the left and catch it and wipe it off and drop it in the bag and walking 2 feet to the right. And my first question was, who is the hell is this? Who is this guy? And you had never seen iron shots hit like this man could hit them in your life. Had the sweetest, smoothest golf swing you ever seen.
He was a gentleman. He was a good player. And a respectful guy, and there's someone to be around to try to learn. I want to learn how to play golf, so I stuck with him.
Ted Rhodes would change clothes after 9 holes of golf. I mean, he would wear plaid in the morning and change into something solid in the afternoon or vice versa. So, yes, he was one of the best dressers that ever been in the game.
It's just a shame that more people didn't get to see Teddy play golf. If he had been on the regular tour with the regular players, believe me, Teddy could have held his own.
I heard nothing but good things about him, not just his caliber of play, but also his character. Everybody, white and black, said, man, Ted Rhodes was a real gentleman, and he was a great golfer, just didn't get the opportunity to pursue his career.
Two other African-American golfers that cannot be left out of the UGA's storied history are Lee Elder and Pete Brown.
Pete Brown was one of the nicest people that you ever want to meet.
He'd give you the clothes off his back, I think, if you were just asking for it, you know what I mean? That's the way Pete Brown is. Pete Brown is a hell of a nice guy.
Yeah, I hate being known as a nice guy. See, see, nice guys finish last. And I think they are right.
In 1964, during the Waco Turner Open, he came of age. He became the first African-American to win a PGA Tour sanctioned event.
In 1969, Charlie Sifford won the Los Angeles Open and thought that might mean a trip to Augusta, Georgia and the Masters. It did not. But 5 years later, a young man who had dominated the Black United Golfers Association won the Monsanto Open in Pensacola, Florida. And with that, carried the hopes of all African-American golfers onto the pristine fairways of Augusta National. That was Lee Elder, the first Black man to play in the Masters in 1975, thus breaking down a barrier, whether perceived or real.
Lee Elder won the Pensacola Open, and it was called the Monsanto Open at that time. And I happened to be there when he won the event. And I just remember my dad almost give me a second here. Going into tears. It motivated me a lot.
With all the obstacles I went through, I wanted to do what I wanted to do, and I wanted to play golf, and I ain't never wanted to quit.
Charlie Sifford, well, he's my hero. You know, he's the one that broke the color line, so guys like me, you know, can have an opportunity to compete on any stage. He opened that door for me, and he kicked it open.
In 1961, Charlie Sifford became the first African American to obtain a PGA Tour card, allowing him to play regularly on the tour.
Charlie Sifford was a great player and a great guy. He was certainly a guy that you wanted to watch. He could make it happen.
Charlie's told me some wild stories. I mean, the things that he had to endure. He is the Jackie Robinson of our sport. To endure what he did and to, you know, to have the success he's had, not too many people can withstand that and actually go out there. I mean, golf is not exactly an easy sport to play. And even at the highest of levels, it's even more difficult. The focus and the concentration that you need, and you must have. And he had the focus even harder and more intense than anybody else.
The Phoenix Open was contested. They were sent out in the first group, a foursome of them. Charlie Sifford, I think, was away on the green. And in moving the flagstick, he detects something very nasty and vile. In the cup, turned out to be human excrement. That was the most extreme example of the welcome mat being not so welcome.
They didn't want to see us out there in that tournament in Phoenix, so that's why they did that. But we didn't quit.
He hit his ball down the fairway, and the kid, I don't know if it was the kid, whoever, went out there and put a bucket on his ball. And they had a whole big controversy about having to move the bucket. How are you gonna penalize a man when somebody put a bucket on top of your ball? Well, it's pitiful, I'm telling you the truth.
You know, for Charlie being denied access to so many events, you know, he had the talent to play. It's just truly amazing that, stuck with it.
Well, buddy, if you got treated like that and you didn't get bitter, then somebody had to talk to you because you should have been bitter.
Well, the reason they say I was mean because there was no laughing and smiling and having fun out there like Lee Trevino and Chichi Rodriguez, because I didn't see anything funny. I saw people making money, you understand, and I couldn't make any money because I was Black.
Like I traveled a lot with Sifford, and he was always a fighter. And just traveling with him made me as much of a fighter as he was.
You know, you never can tell about this game. This, you have to get out and play and work hard, and whatever comes off, you have to accept it.
To be able to accept that kind of treatment that they were getting and still be able to excel in what they were doing had to be a very strong-willed person. And I, if you talk to anybody, I don't think nobody's ever going to tell you that Charlie was not a strong-willed person.
I mean, the struggles that he had to get on the tour and the rule changes that had to take place on the tour for Charlie to get there, he was obviously a pioneer. And I think he did it gracefully. He did it well, and he did it with and held his head up high with great integrity. So I've got great respect for Charlie Sifford, always have had and always will have.
You know, I tell Charlie all the time, I say, God picked the right man to be the pioneer, Charlie, because I'd have been up in that gallery with my two iron man trying to hit somebody.
I was out there to do a job, and I just didn't take no answer, you know. Not a mean guy at all.
Well, I think the fact that he was recently inducted into the World Golf Hall of Fame and received honors from St. Andrews in Scotland is a testament to where others who are capable of making that kind of judgment place Charlie Sifford in the pantheon.
And I would like to be known. I would like for, to be known, you understand, that Charlie Sifford was an all right guy. That's all, you know.
Well, not only the golfing community, but everyone should know who they were, what they had to endure. They were true pioneers. And if it wasn't for, you know, their focus and their dedication to the great love of the game of golf, you know, as I said, my father probably wouldn't have played the game because he wouldn't have access to the game. And hence, I wouldn't have never played the game. I would never been introduced to the game of golf. So, you know, in essence, I owe, you know, my entire career to them and their pioneering efforts.
We'll hitch our hopes to a star, and with a little love in our hearts, we'll get over. We'll get over. Things in life we desire may seem a little hard to come by, but we'll get over. We'll get over. Disappointment won't be no hinder if we let love be our defender. We'll get over. Gonna